First of all, I wish to thanks the Beta Spin team. So actually we are working in Spintronic since 2003. And one of our main activities basically in the last few years is related to the development of Spintronic diodes in order to have an available technological, commercial available technology. So let's thanks also the funding agencies, in particular the Italian Space Agency, and also the Ministero degli Affari Esteri e della Cooperazione Internazionale, which basically funded a joint lab with my friends of Minzeng. So basically it's the Beta Spin Joint Lab, where we are able to join the effort. In particular, we typically do design of devices, using data-driven design, and Professor Zeng is able to realize these devices in their lab. Actually, they have access to a very good nano facility. Anyway, we have also some contact with companies which sponsor some specific project, and this is the outline of my talk. This is going to be a brief introduction of the history of the spintronic diodes, which are the motivation. In particular, I will focus on microwave detection, resonant and broadband detection. So let's start with the motivation. So actually, the IoT market has grown from 2016 up to this year two times. In particular, there are $253 billion. And in order to face, to approach this market, you can develop two types of things. One is the product, and this is going to cover almost $110 billion US dollar, or you can develop services. Of course, spintronics can impact this market just in terms of product. And in order to be useful for IoT, you need to have low cost, low energy, and of course, high performance at the same time. And spintronics seems to be a story which can drive all these properties at the same time. So this is why it makes sense study spintronic solutions for this technology. A typical IoT node can be observed here in this slide, and the spintronic can be used to realize sensors. Also to make some computing activities. Also can be used to develop the storage elements with the well-established STT MRAM technology, but also to develop transceiver. And we show how to use also spintronic for energy harvesting. So the spintronic diodes, the discovery of spintronic diodes date back to 2005, from the paper by Tulapurkar et al. And in this paper, they show how the rectification effect occur in magnetic tunnel junction. So basically, if you apply an AC current, if the amplitude is not very large, actually the system responds in a linear regime. So you have an alternative magnetoresistive signal which oscillates at the same frequency with different phase. And then you can get a voltage which is given by the product of these two, and basically this voltage is characterized by the C component and a component which oscillates at two times the input frequency. However, the first paper, the sensitivity of which has been computed in the first paper was 1.4 volt over watts, which is very small. Basically, the sensitivity is one of the main metrics to characterize us spin torque diodes, which is very far away from the standard. I mean, at that time was very far away from the semiconductor technology. After that, the main application of the spin diode effect was the characterization of damping-like field-like torque in magnetic tunnel junction. And there was a systematic study in Cornell where basically they did a study as a function of field current, and they found out that the maximum sensitivity was around 25, which still was too low for practical application. However, there was a milestone in material science a few years around 2010, where basically the group by Ono was able to develop the first perpendicular magnetic tunnel junction. And this was possible because of a new interaction, which was interfacial interaction between the oxygen of the MgO and the iron of the cobalt iron boron, which are the key element of this magnetic family junction. And this electrostatic interaction gave rise to a new anisotropic term, and which can be taken into account in the energy landscape of magnetics like an additional field. And this field can be controlled by the thickness of the cobalt iron boron. And in particular, below the critical thickness, actually, it is possible to have an autoplane equilibrium configuration, an autoplane Z axis. And thanks to that, and to the fact that we can control the anisotropy, we can design different configuration of magnetic family junction, in particular one where the polarizer is in plane and the free layer is autoplane. In this type of configuration, and thanks also to the voltage control of the magnetocrystal anisotropy, so which means that this interfacial anisotropy depends also on the voltage you apply across the MTJ, the group of Krivorotov was able to get a spintronic diode with a sensitivity larger than around 500 volt over watts. Which still is not an impressive number, but is competitive, start to be competitive with this semiconductor technology. In this paper, they were focused on passive diodes. When you add in the game also an additional current, so DC current, actually there was a very impressive improvement in the performance, in particular when nonlinear effect take place. The first one was published still by the same group, where they demonstrated a sensitivity of 25,000 volt over watts, and the sensitivity was given by the non-adiabatic stochastic presence. In the first solution here, you have low temperature and field. In order to move to the room temperature, we need to move to the nonlinear resonance. In order to remove the solution of this field, the need of this field, we propose a solution which use the injection locking mechanism. So actually, we have designed a magnetic tunnel junction which can be biased by DC current, and the current necessary to drive self-oscillation is very small. Because of this, when we couple together with the DC current also an AC current, we were able to get a sensitivity of 7,000, 25.6 thousand volt over watts, which for this time was the record value. And but the main advantage is that this sensitivity has been achieved at zero field, making this device very competitive in terms of for commercial product. Still, we have basically just to understand how it works. So if we apply just the DC current, we observe self-oscillation. So actually, you see here, in particular, we designed the device to have a strong nonlinearity. As you can see here, you have a jumps between two different modes. When you apply together with the DC current, also the AC current, and in particular you work near the strongly nonlinear region, you can get injection locking. And if you analyze the detection property within this region, because when you inject lock, when there is the injection locking, the magneto resistance and the current oscillate at the same frequency, so they in principle can give rise to a detection voltage, a DC voltage. And basically, what we find out is that together with the standard contribution, which is given by this oscillation of the same frequency, which is basically this term in the equation, we have an additional term, which is given by the variation of the DC resistance of the device. And then this is measured here, where you have the value of the DC resistance as a function of current when you have no AC current, and this the same resistance when you have DC current. Because of this change, actually, you have an additional term which give a large contribution to the DC voltage, which is because it is proportional also to the DC current. And this contribution basically give rise to this large improvement in the device performance. So we also did the systematic study. One of the outcome of this project is the consolidation of a technology which gave rise to sensitivity larger than 200 kilovolts over watts. And basically, these are numbers which are reasonable for application. In particular, the output resistance is smaller than 1 kilo ohm, so which is a value which is smaller than the Schottky diodes, where you have around 5 kilo ohm. And just to let you know where we are, actually, we are around in this position here. However, this is not actually the limit of this diode, because very recently, let's say 1 or 2 months ago, has come out a paper by Professor Suzuki group. In particular, they get a sensitivity which is one order of magnitude larger with respect to the one we have observed. And still, they use injection locking, but indeed they need an external feed here. And they take advantage of the Boulle-Mitter effect. So basically, they, together with the other two terms, what's happening here is that because the device heat is heating up, you have this an additional current, thermal current, which basically improved the performance in thermal sensitivity. This is an example of this last experiment. But you see that for an input power of around 3 nanowatts, you can get a voltage larger than 8 milliwatts, which is really a huge number considering the input power level. And basically, this moved the spintronics in a configuration where we are very, very competitive with all of the possible detectors which are actually developed. And in particular, if you want to look in terms of modeling, this additional effect basically can be taken into account by this additional current, which is added to the variation of the DC, of the DC resistance. So in order to have this effect, you need also a variation of the DC resistance in your device. So say that what we explore in this paper was also the application of this diode for computing. In particular, the starting point was this paper we did with Professor Zhang Ming, where basically we considered the possibility to use the ascending branch of the resonant curve of the diode as a building block of neuromorphic computing, and in particular, in this case, for ELU. In that preliminary paper, what we did was to achieve a sense accuracy in terms of the MIST database, which was larger than 90%. And now, what we did also was to design a device where the ascending branch of the curve was much larger than the descending branch, in order to expand to improve the performance of the ELU. And actually, with this, which now can be fitted by a very simple polynomial curve, as you can see here, the red curve, we observed a accuracy which is larger than 98%. And this is where basically all the the neurons of the dense layer, which are ELU, are all the same, but they have this activation function. When we want to study the possibility to have device-to-device variation, so basically each neuron of this ELU layer is different than the other. So basically, in other words, this means that the activation function of each neuron is a curve which is in between the green curve here and the blue curve here. So when we use this, what we find out is that still the accuracy of the neural network is very high, larger than 98%. So it's very close to the ideal case. So this tells us that we can really implement dense layer in hardware using spintronic neurons, and we don't really need to make additional learning process in hardware. So actually, what we can do is we can transfer directly the feature extraction from the software from a software, so we can develop this in software, and then what we can do is to develop all the dense layer with spintronic technology. The last results we had in terms of resonant diode is reported in this slide. So actually is this one. So we have resonant detection, which is characterized by two modes. It was just a paper published a few months ago. And the main application of this is in the frequency shift gain modulation. In particular, data are transferred in, are coded in the frequency of a carrier. And when we transfer this to spintronic diodes through an antenna, what we can see is that if we are at the frequency one, we can have an output of the diodes, which is a negative voltage. If we are at the frequency of the zero, for example, we can have a positive voltage. In this way, actually, with a single device, you are able to demodulate a FSK signal. And this is not very fast modulation scheme like PSK, but this is as a key advantage. Is almost error-free. So this means that if you want to implement this in IoT system, this will give you a stronger robustness in the receiver, which can reduce significantly the energy consumption and the complexity of the device you have to develop. So in order to have this behavior, what we did is to realize a larger MTJ, so where you can excite multiple modes. And these are an example of zero current resonance response. So, all right, just to conclude this first part of my talk, I want to show you which are the conclusion. And in particular, what we think is that because this technology is intrinsically radiation hardness, this can be really impact the application in aerospace. Especially for technology just to be out of out in the space. Very quickly, I want to show you also another results we had in terms of spintronic diode, but now we will focus on broadband diodes. So basically, it's something that we can use to develop spintronic energy harvesting. And typically, you can get energy from different sources. One of these is the wireless power, which can even have directly in the air. And in terms of technology, this was a proposal to recover some heat or dissipation power, convert this in spin current. So this is called spin calorimetronics. And we are proposing how to collect electromagnetic energy to supply some, and convert this noise, which you have in the air, the electromagnetic noise, to something which can be useful to supply some specific devices. And the spintronic diode, if you look to the diagram of this electromagnetic energy harvesting, spintronic diode can impact basically this block, which is composed by rectifier or multiplier. So actually here we can use spintronic diodes. And the motivation is that if you look the actual technology, below 1 microwatts, you have only low barrier Schottky diode, which work, which is very low sensitivity. And it has been proposed that actually MTJ can work below 1 microwatts. And this actually why we need this. The point is why we need to work below these microwatts. Because if you look to the power density of the electromagnetic radiation in the air, this is an example of what we have in London. You see that the power density is smaller than 10 nanowatts over centimeter square. So this is why you need to work at really low power. And with this in mind, and looking at the idea of the group of Professor Slavin, in particular, Alexander Provenko developed this fantastic theory where he proposed to have, if we bias this magnetization autoplane in a Manhattan junction with a proper field, so we can drive a sort of new type of dynamics, which is not resonant. In this particular paper, they predicted this low frequency, sort of low frequency tail behavior. What we did is instead to use a field to create this tilted configuration, we designed properly the interfacial perpendicular anisotropy. And basically putting the thickness of the magnetic junction at the right value. And in order, once we've done this, we can really be sure that we are at tilted configuration because the loops of the field versus the magnetic resistance versus field along the autoplane in plane direction exhibit stresses. So this means that we are along a tilted configuration. And because we are working near the compensation point, actually you have also a second order anisotropy which plays a role. And we have characterized this anisotropy experimentally here. These are the numbers. And together with the anisotropy, we have also the Boussinet. So we have developed a very complex device which basically has several properties which all combined together drives a new type of detection, which can be seen in this slide, the left part, which is basically the broadband. So you see here, this is clearly different than resonance response. And in order to understand which is the type of dynamics in this type of detection, what we did micromagnetic simulation. And what we found out is that broadband detection excites large angle amplitude dynamics. And these are comparison between experiments and simulation data. This is quite different than what already observed in previous paper, because if you increase the power of the inputs, actually you have typically a nonlinear resonance, so where the response become asymmetric. In our case, if you increase the power, the response become is changed from resonance response to broadband response. And this is also different from what observed by Popenko, because in our case, we have no frequency dependence of the amplitude of the rectification curve as a function of the frequency itself. So it's also quite a little bit different. So we need a lot of devices and to increase the bandwidth of this detection. So this is necessary in order to be able to collect more energy from different sources. In particular, with this device, we can collect information, energy from the GSM and the digital television frequencies. And we also did time domain measurements. This is an example. And we apply also different source. And when we apply source together, what we saw is that the detection signal adapt. Still is not, is a little bit less than the sum if we apply the two devices together, but they adapt almost perfectly. Finally, we did a comparison with the Schottky diodes. So the state of the art detectors in this direction. And if we compare this the area and we make a comparison with the conversion efficiency density, which is the power available at the output over the input power. So what we saw is that the broadband diodes exhibit better performance of the Schottky diodes, also because it's much, much smaller. However, if we want to be in the wrong position and we compare device to device performance, here is the slide which summarizes all the stuff. What we see is that still the conversion efficiency is smaller. So now it's not anymore a density, but this is the real conversion efficiency. And however, if we add in the game also resonant diodes, high efficiency resonant diodes, what we saw is that below 1 nanowatts, we still, the spintronic diode still works, while the Schottky diodes absolutely cannot be used. So which are the challenges we are working now? So we want to increase, of course, this performance, and also we want to reduce the power which convert the resonance response to the broadband response. We also demonstrate to be able to supply to the nano devices. In particular, we focused on black phosphorus nano devices. And so we apply light, we characterize the voltage current of the device. Here is the curve. Then we fix a bias point, and then we switch it on and off the light. As you can see here, when the light is switched off, there is no conduction. And this clearly demonstrates that this input signal can be used to supply this type of devices. The question is why we really do a lot of effort to supply black phosphorus transistors or nano devices, because they have very great impact in biomedical applications. In particular, they can be used for cancer imaging, cancer therapy, drug delivery, and actually the possibility to bias this type of device without any batteries from external radiation give a lot of opportunity for their application. So these are basically the results we get when we perform a systematic study, so including the field. So we were able to achieve also a detection band around 2.5 gigahertz, which is the record we get right now. And with that, I just wanted to show you the conclusion of my talk. So we really believe that spintronic diodes are a mature technology for commercial applications. So we really hope that this type of devices will join shortly this STT MRAM technology. And if you're interested to look at this, what an excursus of what we have done in this project, you can just download this paper from the archive that soon will appear in Applied Physics Letters. And I wish one more time to thank Stefan Mignanetis. Finally, I wish to invite you to the conference, to the first hybrid conference we will organize this year in September in Italy. So please stay tuned on that. So thank you very much, and I hope you have questions.